One of the first things that comes to mind when I think of playing AAA games is the incredible animation of characters, not just during cutscenes, but also during gameplay. How can we start to achieve this seemingly AAA level of character interactivity for our own smaller indie games? The answer that we'll explore today is procedural animation. Over the last few months, I've dedicated myself to learning how to program procedural animation in Unity. And the first set of animations that I've created are these subtle environment interactions that you may have seen in popular third-person adventure games. Surprisingly, they add a ton to the character's realism and a player's immersion in the game's world. In this new series here on iHeartGameDev, we'll break down the whole environment interaction system and go over the code step by step so that you can add this procedural animation to your games. Shout out to the patrons who have been so patient and supportive for this series and topic. The full project is now available to download from the link in the description. Let's get started with episode 1, a bite-sized introduction to procedural animation in Unity and setting up our character. In today's Unity project, we have the character Banana Man making its infamous return to the channel. Banana Man can be downloaded for free directly from the Atsu store. Banana Man can stand, walk, and run. All three of these animations are keyframed animations, meaning they are static and always look the same. We'll be learning to make procedural animations, which are dynamic animations that change based on specific conditions or parameters while the game is being played. And in this project, our procedural animations will be programmed to have our character interact with specific objects in the game environment. Let's start by downloading Unity's Animation Rigging Package found under the Unity Registry section of the Package Manager. This package provides components that make procedural animation much easier because they interact directly with Unity's built-in animation system. Let's use this package's components to set up our character. Taking a look at the hierarchy window, we can find and expand our character game object. Notice the hierarchical list of the character's bones, also known as an armature. Using the rigging package's bone renderer component, we can visualize each individual bone in the armature, displaying the character's full skeleton. Here's the fastest way to set this up. Select the root character game object in the hierarchy window, then navigate to the animation rigging dropdown and press bone renderer setup. We can immediately see the character's bones rendered in the scene view. With the root character game object selected, the inspector now shows the bone renderer component with a pre-filled list of all the character's bones. If you notice any bones are missing, simply drag them from the hierarchy onto the top of the transforms list, then disable and re-enable the component for them to show up. Why is this helpful? The bone renderer component makes it much easier and faster to select each individual bone instead of the character's 3D mesh. This will help us as we build the character's rig and decide which parts of the character we want to procedurally animate. And what is a rig, you ask? As simplified as possible, a rig in Unity is a collection of bones and bone constraints that are used for animating the character. And constraints determine how specific bones can move and rotate. Let's add our first rig to our character, and we'll use the fastest method to creating one. With our character selected, let's open the animation rigging menu again, and this time press Rig Setup. Here, a couple things happen. A rig builder component attaches to our character. One of its fields is preset to a new child game object titled Rig1. Rig1 has a rig component attached to it. So Rig1 is our first rig. It will allow us to procedurally control individual bones of our character. But to actually create our procedural animation, we'll need to apply constraint components between bones and other objects, and add required code. We'll handle that later on, but it's important to understand the hierarchy of this setup. The rig builder is attached to the root game object alongside Unity's animator component. The character armature with all of its bones is a child of the root. We create new rig game objects for each procedural animation we want to make, which are also children of the root. Typically, each is named for its general purpose. For example, target tracking. Child game objects are then added with the constraint components necessary to create the procedural effect, and code can update the constraint values. As long as the rig is set in the rig builder, its constraint and weight values will reach Unity's animation system and interpolate between or completely override any keyframed animation values based on what it receives. To quickly summarize this initial setup, we now understand the difference between keyframed animation and procedural animations, and are now rendering the character's bones and have our first rig. The only remaining components before we can procedurally animate our character are constraints and the code. But if you're looking for an even more thorough explanation and introduction to procedural animation before continuing on with environment interactions, all of this and so much more are broken down in my original Introduction to Procedural Animation video. As for this series, are you excited to learn procedural environment interactions in Unity? Leave a comment below letting me know. Great! After just a few minutes, our project has the initial setup complete for our character. In the next episode, we'll take a closer look at the procedurally animated environment interactions from Uncharted 4, and then we'll start to map out our own implementation for our project. Definitely enjoy these shorter episodes while you can, because some of the scripts for the later videos are close to 5 times as long. Thank you to all the patrons for supporting this channel. You too can join the Patreon and get access to all of my project files, including the completed version of this project, right now. And a special shout out to Jupe, TerrorDev, Peter Steiner, Ricky Thonglevong, and Rob Malco for the top tier support. But that is all for today. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next episode.